So what vaccine do we recommend that everybody gets in the United States over the age of 6 months of age annually? It's the influenza vaccine. What vaccine have we said works 70 to 90% of the time for decades? It's the influenza vaccine. What vaccine do we reevaluate every year and reformulate? It's the influenza vaccine. Now, before I tell you much more about the influenza vaccine, I want to remind you about how important vaccines are. This table from the Center for Disease Control and Prevention published last year highlights the role of 15 different infectious diseases in the 20th century. You see the average number of people that would get sick every year in the 20th century. And then you see what we see in 2010 because of vaccines. So drawing your attention to the bottom of that table, you see varicella, chickenpox. We used to see over 4 million cases a year in the 20th century of chickenpox. Now because of vaccines, we see just a little over 400,000. These are profound impacts. In many of these diseases on this table, most of you probably have never experienced because of vaccines. But note, influenza is not on that table. Now, when we think about the public health impact of vaccines, there's four key factors that we have to think about. Efficacy and effectiveness. Does the vaccine protect you? Efficacy is what we get in clinical trials. Effectiveness is what we get in observational studies, the real-world experience, how it works in those doctors' offices. We think about public acceptance. Vaccination is a voluntary activity. You have to be willing to take the vaccines that we recommend for you, or they don't work. Then you think about availability. The vaccine needs to be there when you need it. If it's sitting on a truck somewhere or sitting in a lab, it doesn't help you when you need it. And then we think about safety. Our vaccines today are incredibly safe. They have to be for us to recommend them for you. Now, you think about all four of these factors combined together, and that tells you how much of a public health impact you have with your vaccines. But what if one of those factors is decreased? When you think about what happens if you decrease the protection you get from a vaccine, your impact on the public health decreases too. Now, this little guy is influenza. This is the virus we're talking about today. And there's a couple of key things to remember about influenza. Influenza, we typically associate with human disease, but it's actually got animal reservoir. We see influenza routinely in wild birds, specifically aquatic birds. That's where its reservoir is in nature. And the thing that concerns us is when it goes from those birds to a human, or to another animal, and then to a human. And those events can be the emergence of a pandemic, like we saw in 2009. Now, when influenza transitions, there's all these mutations that occur. These little cartoon characters, the blue and the red, those things change all the time on influenza, which is why we have to reevaluate the vaccine. Those mutations make it difficult for us to respond as it's constantly mutating. Now, we respond with a vaccine. Now, our vaccine that we use today is very similar to what we used in the 1940s when we made a vaccine. It's grown in chicken eggs. We designed our vaccines to elicit an immune response to the hemagglutinin and neuraminidase, the proteins on the outside of influenza, just like we did back then. We've upgraded a bit by using 1970s technology to make it, but it's still in chicken eggs. So that's the trivalent inactivated vaccine, the flu shot we all are familiar with. We also have the live attenuated, the mist that goes up your nose. It's slightly different, but operates on the same principles. Now, this is what we think about when we think about influenza. Somebody's sick. We've all experienced influenza at some point in our life. I vividly remember the last time I had influenza. It was January of 2005. I've never missed an influenza vaccine since. We all think it sucks. Influenza is not a fun thing to get. Now, stop thinking about that last time you had influenza. I want you to think about influenza on a population. What happens when millions of people get influenza? That's where we deal with pandemics. Pandemic influenza is that emergence of a novel influenza strain, something we've never seen before, into human populations. Then it starts spreading rapidly. We saw this in 2009. That was the fourth pandemic we've had in the last 100 years. We now know that 2009 was probably in about 40 countries before we really realized what was going on. It spreads that quick. Now, we had four in the last 100 years. We had one in 1918, we had one in 1957, one in 1968, and then we had 2009. Now, these pandemics have had a wide range of impacts. 1918 we associate with a severe pandemic. And you think about 1918. We were in the middle of World War I. More soldiers died from influenza than from combat. Around 100 million people died in the world in 1918. It was a little smaller back then, 100 million people. Influenza pandemics can have profound impacts. Most of us probably think the 2009 pandemic was a mild event that didn't stress us much. You'll find hospitals around the world that were at the verge of changing their standards of care because we were reaching the maximum of our ICU capacity. But it was a mild disease. When you look at the people that died in 2009, most of them were under the age of 40. Now, one thing that happens with pandemic influenza is it replaces the seasonal influenza strain that was occurring. So now, if you think about it, when you're all getting your flu shot this next year, the 2009 pandemic strain is part of your seasonal flu vaccine now. Pandemics replace a seasonal strain. And now, we typically think about seasonal influenza as no big deal, the thing that puts you on a couch for a week. You got to remember, between 3,000 and 49,000 people die every year from seasonal influenza here in the United States. The impact's even more broad around the world, depending on different conditions. But 3,000 to 49,000, that's not something to ignore. Now, the thing to keep in mind is 90% of these deaths occur in those over the age of 65. Now, this is your iconic image of 1918. We had an overwhelmed medical system. We had millions of people getting treatment in settings just like this, sitting on cots, doctors and nurses doing the best they could to save their life. Well, you think, you know, a lot's changed since 1918. We put a man on the moon. We know influenza is a virus. We had no idea back then. It wasn't discovered until 1933. We think about, we have a vaccine now. First vaccine routine use was in the 1940s. We have modern medicine. We have intensive care. We have emergency room physicians that can do amazing things to save your life. Things like this can still happen. If we have millions and millions of people getting sick all around the world at the same time, it doesn't matter how amazing our medicine is, we're still going to be taking care of people on cots because we don't have that many ICU beds. The only way to stop that is with a vaccine. Now, I mentioned that vaccine was developed in the 1940s, in part because the U.S. military was so concerned about 1918 repeating itself at the beginning of World War II, we figured out how to make a vaccine. So by 1945, we were using an influenza vaccine routinely in the U.S. military. So we've had three pandemics since then, 1957, 1968, and 2009, where we had a vaccine available to combat this pandemic to prevent something like this from occurring. We were very fortunate that the virus didn't cause anything like this because in all three of those pandemics, our vaccine arrived too little and too late. It was not available in sufficient quantities to prevent something like this from occurring if those conditions were present with that virus. Part of that is because it takes 6 to 8 months to make an influenza vaccine. We decide in February what's going to go into that vaccine and start manufacturing it for use in September. Now, when we think about influenza, the literature is extremely broad. And so we wanted to really understand. And so with some collaborators here at the U and at Johns Hopkins and at the Marshfield Clinic, we went back into the literature and we dug really deep. We were looking for the best evidence to understand what kind of protection we can get from influenza vaccines. You know, as science advances, we learn things. We've been working on influenza for over 60 years. So we now know what tests work the best, what methods use the best precision to get information about our vaccine. So we set the bar really, really high. We use the most rigorous study designs and the best diagnostic techniques. And we looked at over 5,700 papers. We narrowed that down to several hundred, and we narrowed that down even further to 31 papers, what we consider the very best information about how well flu vaccines work today. So when you look at this in populations, for the adults over the age of 65, 90% of our mortality, we didn't find a single study for the flu shot, the trivalent activated vaccine, that showed it worked in this population. The live attenuated, we found one. It was mixed results, and it's not licensed for this population in the US. We didn't do too much more on that. 18 to 64 years of age, we found several studies. Average vaccine efficacy of 59% in healthy adults. For the live attenuated, the flu mist, we didn't find any studies that were statistically significant to show protection. Children 8 to 17 years of age, we didn't find any studies. All the studies in young kids were under the age of 7. We found one study for the flu shot. It worked 1 year, didn't work the next year. You can't really summarize that. And then we looked at the live attenuated. This worked incredibly well. 83% protection we saw in young kids, suggesting that the live attenuated vaccine works incredibly well in this population. So we concluded influenza vaccines can provide moderate protection against virologically confirmed influenza, but such protection is greatly reduced or absent in some seasons. We believe the current influenza vaccine will continue to have a role in the reduction of influenza morbidity until more effective interventions are available. We should maintain public support for the present vaccines that are the best interventions available for seasonal influenza. We have to keep using what we have, but we have to have something better. We need to rethink influenza vaccines. Our previous perspective, that 70 to 90% effectiveness that I talked about earlier, suggests that the status quo is good enough. We now know that that doesn't work. We have to recalibrate this perspective. The status quo doesn't work anymore. The reason we have to do this is because following the evidence is our job. Evidence dictates how we do public health promotion and policy. It's not the other way around. And the reason for that is this. This figure shows you how a vaccine is developed. Now, something to keep in mind with this figure is think about the time horizon is up to 10 years, and it's up to $1 billion. And you have cash flow on the left, and that horizontal line in the middle means you're not losing money or making money, you're cash neutral. Now, as you start moving forward in your discovery, you know, the real science behind what you're doing, you know, your cash flow situation starts to decrease, things start to get more expensive. And as you move into that next phase, that preclinical discovery, early clinical trials, your expenses go way up. At this point, you've been spending millions of dollars in several years of your life and your funder's money. And you enter this place we call the Valley of Death. Now, as you enter this, you are hoping to get out of that with a vaccine that you can prove works incredibly well and will change things. That makes you go into a situation where you have a potential for great rewards or great losses. Most vaccines never get through here. Most of them are unsuccessful. Now, to get through there, you need to have that phase three trial, that thing that gives the private sector investor something to invest in your vaccine. Why would you spend millions of dollars of your shareholders' money on a product that you don't know will succeed? That's part of that challenge, because there's game-changing influenza vaccines out there right now that are on the cusp of that valley of death. Vaccines that can provide protection among all ages, not just young, healthy kids, but protect everybody, that can protect you for multiple seasons from influenza. These game-changing vaccines are entering that valley of death right now, and they don't know if they're ever going to emerge, because the perception that our vaccines are good enough is driving R&D, public and private financing, and public policy. There is no incentive for us to pull vaccines through that valley of death right now because of our perception. This is what our future looks like when we change our perception. Instead of 37 million cases of influenza in the 20th century, every year we go to 375,000. It's a 99% reduction, and that is achievable when we change our perspective by 2025. Now, you think this is a major impact for seasonal influenza? Think about pandemics. You can stop them with a vaccine like this. We don't have to worry about pandemic influenza anymore if we have a vaccine that can do this. So we don't have to think about those millions of people getting sick all around the world at the same time, the problems that can happen to our global economy. Those are the vaccines we need today. Those game-changing influenza vaccines occur when we change our perspective.